I'd like to introduce you to today's guest interviewee, a friend of ours at CFO Studio and a friend of mine, Mr. Leonard Williams, the CFO of the Nature Conservancy. As the Nature Conservancy's chief financial officer, Leonard is accountable for managing and directing the organization's finance, investment, and business services functions, while also supporting the design and execution of the company's overall strategy and providing the leadership and management necessary to ensure that the Conservancy has support programs, operational controls, financial, administrative, and reporting procedures, financial systems, and human capital, all of it in place to ensure financial strength, operating efficiency, and competitive advantage in support of the conservation mission. Leonard joined the Conservancy in 2018 and has over 20 years of financial, operational, and technological management experience in mission-focused and value-driven organizations. Leonard is a trusted advisor, leader, and big-picture thinker, with substantial experience in controlling costs, identifying opportunities that create value, advancing organizational culture, and driving innovation with a passion for building loyal and motivated teams that collaborate and contribute to a culture of success. Leonard holds an MBA in finance and decision sciences from the Wharton Graduate Business School, an MSEE in Computer and Information Technology, and a BSE in Computer Science from the University of Pennsylvania. As you can tell, Leonard's a real slouch, rather accomplished individual. And he has completed postgraduate studies at MIT in the Darden School's Graduate Executive Education Program. Oh, wow. A frequent speaker at professional conferences in 2014, Leonard was named first runner-up as NFP CFO of the Year by the Washington Business Journal and Practitioner of the Year by the industry group Inside NGO. Rather impressive career. A little background on the Nature Conservancy. The mission of the Nature Conservancy is to conserve the lands and waters on which all life depends. The Nature Conservancy is proud of what it's accomplished since its founding in 1951. The Nature Conservancy has protected more than 117 million acres of land and 5,000 miles of rivers worldwide. And it operates more than 100 marine conservation projects globally. Nature Conservancy has more than 1 million members and works in all 50 United States and 72 countries around the world, protecting habitats from grasslands to coral reefs, from Australia to Alaska to Zambia. The Nature Conservancy addresses threats to conservation involving climate change, fire, fresh water, forests, invasive species, and marine ecosystems. If you'd like to learn more about the Nature Conservancy, visit www.nature.org/aboutus. So, it gives me great pleasure, it really does, to introduce you today to my friend, today's CFO Live interviewee, Leonard Williams, CFO of the Nature Conservancy. Leonard, it's so nice to have you join us here on CFO Studio Live. Welcome. Nice to see you.
Oh, it's a pleasure, Andrew. This is something I've been looking forward to for some time. I want to thank you and all of the folks at CFO Live for creating this opportunity for me. And also want to thank many of my colleagues at the Nature Conservancy who supported me in getting ready for this very important conversation. But before we begin, Andrew, just let me say a couple of things that I believe are really relevant to the times that we are currently working in. Given the mission of the Nature Conservancy, it would be very easy for this organization to be one that just, you know, sort of focus only on the pure hard sort of conservation work that we do, and then pay very much attention at all to the growing set of very important social changes that are coming, that are facing our society today. And I just want to take the opportunity to let all my colleagues at the Conservancy know, and let the folks on this call know, that the Conservancy has provided enormous opportunities for its staff and for its and for people like myself in leadership positions to become engaged in areas around equality, justice, social justice, and connecting that back to environmental justice. We really feel strongly about these things, and as we go forward, we are not going to we are going to be focusing as much on how we, in fact, engage people as well as we engage place as we work to not only conserve the world, conserve this planet, but also create opportunities for social and environmental justice.
Well, you know what? Not surprised to hear you say those things. Great words. And from an organization as impressive as the Nature Conservancy, more power to you.
Thank you.
Leonard, you know, it goes without saying that these are most unusual times, confusing in many respects, interesting in other respects. Not to suggest that there's anything positive associated with a pandemic and the difficulty and the pain and the sorrow that many people are experiencing. But from a business perspective, there are some very interesting things going on. So before we talk about that, in general, how has the Nature Conservancy fared during the crisis, both, you know, from a health and a business perspective?
That's a great question, Andrew. And from a, let's start first from a health perspective, because at the Conservancy, we really do view our employees and our staff as being our most valuable asset. And we really have worked in how we have been structuring our business to, in every instance, provide a safe and effective environment for people to operate in. We are fortunate at the Nature Conservancy that we have, over the course of the Conservancy's existence almost, been very much of a dispersed organization, one that values very highly the autonomy of its local chapters. As a consequence, when it came time for us to begin to operate in a very dispersed mode because we were shutting down many of our office buildings, we already had in place a set of policies, practices, and procedures, as well as a number of technologies that allowed us to operate very effectively in this very dispersed, working remotely kind of environment. The challenge that we face, though, is that people can only run like that in that remote operating mode for a limited amount of time. You can only go so far with adrenaline and mission focus. And eventually you come to a place where people really begin to think, well, we as an organization are going to have to begin making some additional changes in how we operate ourselves and the support that we're going to be giving to our staff in order to help them remain effective and efficient. And this is especially true for many of our staff who happen to have school-age children at home or who are caring for a spouse or a partner who may be suffering from the disease or who may have an elderly parent living with them. So as we look across our population, we're going to be moving away from, well, okay, you've got a computer you can work with at home, you've got great internet access that we're willing to pay for, and to start thinking more about, well, how can we help you with things like childcare? How can we help you with things like the emotional support that you're going to need as you know, as this work at home extends for maybe 2 or 3 months to 6 or 9 months? And how can we as an organization be supportive of you in terms of creating some soft collaboration spaces that will allow you to sort of recreate, as it were, some of the collaborations that you had on. So for us, that's really the next sort of big lift that we see organizationally, and that myself and others as executive leaders in the organization are going to be wrestling with as we go forward. In terms of the business itself, coming in, we and at the end of FY20, which for our fiscal year ended in June of this year, we were in a position where we were just coming to the close of a very successful capital campaign. In fact, FY20 results from a fundraising perspective were in fact the best results we've had in the history of the organization. So we combining that with the fact that me and my staff, because I also manage the investment portfolio of the business, had begun moving more into cash beginning in the fourth calendar quarter of 2019 and in the first calendar quarter of 2020. We made that change because we had seen a couple of inversions of the yield curve in November and December of last year. And as a precaution, thinking that we might be heading for a recession, began to stockpile some cash so we'd be in a position to weather that out. So we found ourselves in that March, April timeframe when things were going to heck in a hand wagon with sufficient cash on hand for us to weather that downturn and had a portfolio that was less focused on domestic equities, much more focused on things like private equity and hedge funds, and with a book of cash at the ready that allowed us to weather that storm and at the same time allowed us to be as generous as we could reasonably be with our staff in terms of providing them the support that they needed as we went through the first two or three months of the pandemic. So FY20, great year. In fact, one of the best years financially that we've had. In terms of the staff, I think our staff have done an incredible job of keeping the business going in that March, April, May, June, July timeframe. The challenge we're going to have is that as we look forward now across August, looking to perhaps as late as January, can't expect people to keep running on adrenaline, can't expect people to keep running on mission strength. We're going to have to start coming up with some more tools and techniques that can allow people to continue to be effective while we give them additional tools, stipends, or whatever it takes in order to help make them.
Well, Leonard, it sounds like you guys were very, very thoughtful about this, at the outset and prior to the pandemic. But you also said something that I found was very interesting. A lot of companies talk the talk, as they say, and say, our employees are our best assets. Mm-hmm. But listening to you, it's obvious that the Nature Conservancy truly believes that, not only talks the talk, but walks the walk. Mm-hmm. It sounds like, you know, you're giving a very substantial amount of thought as to how these people will continue, not just to perform, but to exist, how your staff will be able to maintain decent lives. I applaud you and your team for thinking that way, and for putting it into action. But in that same vein, I wanted to ask you, prior to the pandemic, did the Nature Conservancy have a large percentage of its employees working from home, or did that occur as a result of the pandemic?
Well, actually, Andrew, at any one point in time, we probably would have had about 40 to 45% of our staff working either remotely, from home or out on the road working. We generally would only have people coming into our offices about maybe two, 3 days a week, excepting those folks who are doing things like accounts receivable, accounts payable, some of the core financial stuff. Obviously, some of the folks that are working to support our IT organizations, some of our lawyers, they tend to come in more frequently. But the guys and gals that were involved in our core science, our core conservation work, even many of the folks that are involved in our fundraising, marketing, and development work, were able to expect, with many times, especially folks in development, were expected to not be in office very much, but actually out in front of potential donors. So we really had built up a network of using a couple of very effective wide area networks, very strong security. Set of protocols we had established to enable people to work remotely and work remotely as if they were in their office behind our full corporate firewall.
Were there any particular technologies that the Nature Conservancy put into place that beyond the digital video conferencing and the broadband, anything in particular that helped the organization continue on its mission?
No, actually, we were able to pretty much just leverage many of the tools that we had in place already. We made a more forceful push on the security side to make sure that everyone had the right encryptions on their laptops, that we were fully encrypting all of the data that were on edge devices attached to the network. That kind of thing, because once you move away from the formal firewall, there are a lot of spamware and other security intrusions that you become more susceptible to. So we did take some additional steps to support edge devices. But beyond that, not that very much more. No, we were in pretty good shape coming into this. Well, we're able to leverage that technology and leverage the culture of the organization in order to continue to keep operating.
And you've been able to continue the mission as a result.
Yes, we have. Now, obviously, some of the work that we would like to have done in some of our preserves, we've not been able to do. And that's because we had some states that we operate in that were on full lockdown. So as a consequence, you know, you're not able to have people out doing research in or working around some of our outdoor preserves. The same thing was true for some of the conservation projects that we had people working on, where they were working under grants from various grantors. Again, you know, while we might have been able to work remotely, some of our partners might not have had that same opportunity. So that tended to slow up some of the work that we would have been able to do otherwise. But for that work that we were able to control and contain ourselves, we were able to pretty much continue that at a pace.
Well, you know, they say that there are a lot of heroes that emerge when there's chaos. And certainly everyone in this country and around the world are thankful for the folks who, you know, the real heroes, the doctors, the nurses, the people who delivered everything from food to supplies, even the janitors who are cleaning the floors so that people can, you know, stay healthy and eat in restaurants and be saved in hospitals. I mean, there's so many heroes that have emerged from what's going on. But I think it's important to acknowledge something that you said a moment ago, because there's another set of heroes that I think we need to acknowledge. The technology worked. You know, we all kind of went home on a Tuesday and kept our fingers crossed and hoped that the technology was going to work. And it did. And I not to diminish the good works that the true heroes in life are doing today, but from a business perspective, my view is that the true heroes from a business perspective today are the IT executives, the folks who built the backbone that's sustained under tremendous weight of everyone having every conversation either by cell phone, landline, or video.
Right.
You know,
right.
Every minor conversation where you used to walk down a hall and knock on somebody's door and stick your head in and say, you got 2 minutes, that all happens now by cell, email, hardline, or video. Mm-hmm. And the back, you know, we all experienced our bumps and bruises, but the backbone worked and it's still working. Thank God. And I think the IT execs are the heroes of the business component of what we've been doing. Let's talk about bigger picture for a moment. Let's talk about your views on the global economy. The suspension of so many components of, you know, the U.S. and the global economy, how does that trickle back? How does that affect the Nature Conservancy's ability to take on new projects and continue the mission?
In a couple of ways, Andrew, we are fortunate in that, unlike many NGOs, we have a very healthy portfolio that allows us to do some things that other NGOs might not necessarily be able to do, especially in today's environment. And we are committed to leveraging that portfolio to continue the good work that we've set out in front of us. It's important, and that's the reason why is that this is not money that we're holding as an investment simply so that we can say, geez, look at how much money we have. But rather, this is the result of contributions and gifts and bequests that people have made to this organization over the years with the intent that we would, in fact, look at rainy days like this and leverage that portfolio to continue to advance the mission of the organization. That really is what our mission is going to be, to take, to leverage that portfolio, leverage those savings prudently and efficiently, but leverage them nevertheless to continue to advance the mission, one. Secondly, I know in terms of the broader, you know, sort of environment that we're facing, our expectation for FY21 is that we would see a substantial downturn in contributions, gifts, and fundraising for this organization. And that's principally because our expectations are that, notwithstanding where the S&P 500 may be heading now, or where the Dow Jones 30 industrials are heading right now. We do feel that the vast majority of people out there are going to feel a real decline in their personal wealth. And so while we may still continue to see the very large and very generous gifts that we have been traditionally the recipients of, it is those guys and gals who would, at the end of the year, think about the important mission that we are providing and write us a check for $50, $100, $250, something like that. Those are the folks that are not going to be able to continue to do that going forward, especially in light of everything that's going on. And that really is a not insubstantial portion of the monies that we have coming into us. So we do expect to see our income flatten out a bit, if not decline somewhat in FY21. But we do expect, we will be backfilling that a bit with the reserves that we have in our portfolio. Additionally, we have had to, as a result of the expected downturn in some of
our... Could you repeat that, Leonard? I didn't hear your last statement.
I said, even though we are expecting to see a bit of a downturn in some of our gifts and contributions and requests in FY21, mainly because of just the absence of a wealth effect that many of our sponsors and contributors might have. We will continue to try to push the organization forward and the mission forward, leveraging the reserves and savings that we have. That all being said, though, we are very much aware we have had to, unfortunately, lay off a little over 100 people in the organization. And that's only out of a set of about 4,000 people. So not a heck of a whole lot on a percentage basis. But for every one of those 100 people, it was a very important event and one that we worked diligently to try and avoid. Additionally, we've also had to furlough a number of folks as well. But the notion of having those furloughs is that as soon as we find ourselves in a place where we would feel comfortable bringing those people back into the organization, we intend to do so.
So what happens after the crisis? Will the Nature Conservancy consider changes in how it operates and maybe changes in the mission? Will the mission evolve in some way as a result of the crisis?
I think the mission... is not going to evolve all that very much. I think the notion that we have in front of us, which is to the conservation of the planet, doing whatever we can to mitigate the amount of carbon that we've got out there, take on issues around climate change, work to ensure the availability of fresh water. Those kinds of things still remain important. In fact, critically important. The challenge that we're going to have, though, is that I don't think we're ever going to be back in a place where you're going to have 300-500 people working in a large office building. I think that we're going to find ourselves in a place where we will probably be back working in a much more sort of locally focused environment with decisions which have traditionally been made in this organization very much at a local level, but now made perhaps an even more hyper-local level. Taking into consideration the realities on the ground of the particular region that we're at. And I say that as an example. I use it as an example of the fact that we, while we're here in the United States, we continue, as everyone does, to struggle with the rates of infection and the growth in the number of cases. However, in places like New Zealand, where we have offices, China, where we have a facility, some parts of Europe, where we have offices, we will probably be reopening many of those offices sooner rather than later, simply because of the conditions existent in some of those countries. So as I said before, we're not going to be able to say that, that there's going to be a one size fits all for the operating model that we have. It's going to be one that's going to be affected in a very profound way by this pandemic. We even today don't know what social distancing means in an office environment, right? In the United States, especially. However, in places like New Zealand, in places like China, some places in Europe, we may in fact move back into an operating model that's not that very much different from the one that existed before the pandemic. But we may be looking at places like, not to pick on any one country, but places like a Brazil, places like a Venezuela, some places in sub-Saharan Africa where the ability to react and control the infectious rates have not been as successful as they've been in other parts of the world. Well, we may end up with a very different operating model than the one that we had before the pandemic. So we are fortunate that we've got some very creative and very bright people working in this organization at the local level to whom we've given, I think, sufficient leeway to make the kind of decisions that they need to make in light of the local conditions. And as a result, I think we'll be able to continue the mission, but with operating models that may vary a bit from geography to geography, given realities on the ground.
So, Leonard, well, then that takes me to another question, wanting to get a sense as to the, you know, the other mission-based organizations, other tax-exempt organizations. How do you think that your peers, your tax-exempt mission-based peers, are faring in the current climate?
Well, you know, Andrew, I sit on an environmental roundtable, and it consists of about 25 or 30 CFOs from a real potpourri of environmental organizations, from some as small as 10, 15, 20 employees all the way up to organizations our size and even some a bit larger. And unfortunately, some of the smaller organizations are really being challenged by this. They are not necessarily in a position where they have deep pockets available to them to sustain their operations across this next period. They're also challenged by the fact that they may not necessarily have the technologies available to continue to operate in a truly remote and dispersed environment. Then there's probably a middle group there that's, the guys and gals that are probably in that, maybe $100 million to $400 million kind of revenue range that have a sufficiently diverse set of funding streams. That they'll be able to, they'll be able to carry themselves through. But again, even for them, they may not necessarily have the deep financial back, portfolios behind them like we and some others do. And they're going to have to be making some hard decisions about which aspects of their programmatic work they're going to be able to continue to do, and which they may, in fact, unfortunately, have to walk away from. And then I think there's probably a third set, which is the sort of the people refer to as the big green organizations, ourselves, people like World Wildlife Foundation, Sierra Club, that kind of thing, who have strong financial backing, very dedicated sponsors and supporters, donors who are who consistently provide support to those organizations. I'm not going to say we'll be just fine, but I think that we have the resources to weather this for the next little while. And I think we'll be reasonably okay. Mm-hmm. But even for people like us, I think the organizations are going to be looking very closely at some of the things that they've been doing up to now. And use this as an opportunity to determine whether or not they're going to continue the whole spectrum of work that they were doing in the past going forward. Mm-hmm.
So, Leonard, in our discussions with CFOs, we hear all different kinds of guidance, and very often the guidance we hear is dependent upon the company size or the industry or their specific circumstances. But interestingly enough, we're hearing from a large number of CFOs that the intention as a result of the work from home effort working successfully, that a lot of companies are seriously considering increasing their work from home employee base and leaving it in place permanently. Then we have other CFOs who say that they're considering a greater geographic diversification of employees and offices, especially for critical operating functions like customer care and others, finance. Given the unique manner in which a mission-based organization like the Nature Conservancy functions, what do you think the future is? Do you, you mentioned before reopening offices. Is it just a matter of reopening offices? Is it a matter of going more toward geographic diversification? Is it increasing work from home employee base, or is it some combination, or is it something else?
I think it's going to be a combination as well as a few other new things as well, Andrew. It's interesting when you talk about the geographic disbursement of certain functions. I remind people that that my head of FP&A lives and works in Wisconsin. My chief of staff lives and works in Minnesota. The person who provides much of our financial advice and support to our Asia Pacific region lives and works in Seattle, Washington. So, I stepped back and thought about this as we were moving people out of the building as we were shutting down because of the pandemic. Only two of my direct reports actually live here in the Washington, three now actually live here in the Washington, D.C. area. The other seven are literally scattered across the country. So, and I'm not unusual in that regard. We have had and we expect to continue to have a geographically dispersed organization with people working either from home or working in regional offices that best fit the tempo of what they need to do and reflects an appropriate work and lifestyle balance. Now, that being said, as I would also remind people, I'm not going to have guys and gals opening checks at their dining room table. I'm not going to have people doing accounts payables from their from the kids' rec room. I mean, there are some things that rightly or wrongly we will need to have done in a fairly secure and protected environment. So whether that is done in a traditional office setting or whether that's done in a regional work center remains to be seen. But to the extent that we can give people the flexibility to work from home, we certainly are going to. It's not something new for us. Mm-hmm. The challenge, though, is that I don't think we're going to be forcing people to necessarily work from home. I think there will always be some folks who, until this pandemic gets under better control, until there's a vaccine that's out there that's safe, effectively, and widely available, there will always be people who will say who will not necessarily be interested in returning into an office environment. Sure. So that's something we're sensitive to, and we're not in a place where we're going to be forcing people to go back into an office. Hmm. That being said, there are some functions that are really done best in an office environment, and for those, we will need to find some mix of office work versus working from home versus perhaps having people meet up at a Starbucks, just not to give them a commercial here, but to meet in an environment like that, if they really need to do something. Some of our conservation workers and conservation and scientists have, for instance, this summer, meeting in parks where they can sit around a bench, put in place appropriate social distancing, but at the same time have that opportunity to collaborate around some of the very important projects that they're working to advance. Hmm. So we will find a way to get the job done, and we will depend very often on the creativity of our staff to identify what those ways are. And I think that's what the future for this organization is going to be.
Well, it sounds like you're getting the job done as we speak.
Yep.
Yeah. So let's go back to the global economy for a moment. With all that's going on, with all the change and the evolution and the uncertainty, what would you say the near-term and long-term effects will be of the pandemic on, let's talk about U.S. and global economies?
Sure. I think that, Andrew, the performance of the S&P 500 and performance of especially the performance of the S&P 500, to a certain extent, the performance of the NASDAQ, has clouded the perceptions about the global economy.
Could I ask you to speak a little louder? Because
I'm sorry about that. I believe that the relative performance of some of the financial indexes have clouded the actual performance of the larger true economy. Mm. If you look at S&P 500, Once you pull out the FANG stocks, the Facebooks, the Apple, Netflix, Google, a couple of other Microsoft, a couple of other large stocks that really make up the bulk of the capitalization of the S&P 500. Once you pull them out, the S&P 500 has not performed very well at all this year. And I think that's indicative of where the larger economy is going. Andrew, with 40 million people collecting unemployment benefits, it's hard for me to imagine that somehow or the other, this country is experiencing the level of economic success that is perhaps being evidenced by the performance of some of the financial indexes. So my concern really is that as we are looking at the United States, is that one, we have been beyond fortunate with the way that the government has provided things like the PPP loans, has provided things like the enhanced unemployment insurance benefits, has provided the $1,200 checks that have been sent out to folks. That really has kept this economy on life support on the consumer side. And candidly, the efforts of the Federal Reserve to effectively just open up the cash window, and it's been come one, come all, irrespective that money effectively for free, has been able to keep the wheels of the financial side of the economy turning as well. I don't see how that works over the longer term, though.
Yeah.
The deficits that are being incurred as a consequence, the additional cash that's being pumped into the marketplace will eventually, end up with us facing some level of inflation, or at worst, stagflation as we go forward. And that's the real concern I have about the United States. As you look more globally, though, I see China recovering smartly from the pandemic. They've had a couple of fallbacks because of some second waves that have hit, but I think they're beginning to rebuild their economy. And the same thing is starting now to happen in the Eurozone. So I really do believe that the ability of the United States to remain an integral and important part of the global economy is always going to be there. However, understanding that a substantial portion of our economy was built around consumerism, and given the fact that consumers may now be facing a period over the next 6 to 9 months, unless something very special happens from the administration, of not necessarily having that kind of support, it's going to be hard for me to imagine the economy not slipping into a recession or slipping into stagflation.
Yeah.
And on the other side, with respect to the money supply, again, you cannot continue to keep pushing this kind of money into the marketplace without eventually triggering inflation, as those dollars then begin to chase relatively few hard assets and start creating asset bubbles as well.
Well, your points are all well taken. I mean, there really is no free lunch. And, I concur that I'm pleased that the output that we've received from the government, and I know there's more coming, or believe there's more coming, but that's future money, and we're going to have to pay that back, and it's going to have a very, very significant price. Yeah. It would have a significant price either way, either today. Exactly. And I think the cost would be considerably more today if we didn't have the assistance from the government. But I think all your points are very well taken. You mentioned employment in your last comments. Mm-hmm. Before this happened, we were beyond full employment as a country and mm-hmm. many other parts of the world too. So what do you think the long-term effects will be on the availability of employees? We've got a lot of people out of work today. Mm-hmm. Do they remain out of work? Will there be an abundance of available employees? Will they be inspired to go to work? Because we're hearing stories about people who prefer to stay on unemployment. So what do you think the long-term employee availability picture is?
Yeah, I think it's that, as unfortunately, and unlike in the last recession that we had back in the 2008-2010 timeframe, the impact of the reduction in employment levels has landed most squarely on folks in the service industries. and within that service industry, even more squarely on the backs of millennial women. Mm. And I'm horribly afraid that we could be looking at a world where a substantial percentage, 10, 15, maybe 20% of those folks, of those millennial women, may not necessarily ever have a job to come back to because of the way that the service economy will be deflected and depressed over the next little while. One. Two, again, we say with Jesus, these guys and gals that are in the service economy, not making a lot of money anyway, so you know, what's the big deal? I think that's, you know, a rather cynical way to come at it. But I think at the same time, though, just the vast numbers of people that we're talking about is going to have a depressing effect upon our economy. Even if the actual wage dollars that segment of the economy was generating might not be as large as perhaps you might see if that was, you know, same number of people were out of work in other sections of the economy. Hmm. Just the social and cultural impact of having that many people out of work, that many people struggling to make ends meet, it's going to have a profound impact on our society, a profound impact on how we structure social safety nets going forward, and how we, you know, structure jobs in this country going forward as well.
Leonard, your thoughts have been great. You've been gracious with your time. You've been transparent with your knowledge, and I'm so grateful that you chose to participate with us at CFO Studio Live. I want to thank you very much for sitting with us today. I know your time is incredibly valuable. I'm glad that you're healthy and that you're so willing to share your ideas with us. I before I thank our audience, I'd like to take a look at a couple of the questions we've gotten from our audience. First one has to do with government rescue measures. You mentioned earlier, it actually ties back to something you said earlier about the stock markets and some of the large companies' performance. Mm-hmm. The question is, do you expect that government rescue measures will be enough to keep large companies afloat along with the U.S. economy?
Oh, for sure. And I think, and for some of the larger companies, Andrew, it's going to be less of an issue of government rescue measures as much as the actions of the Fed. I mean, it's the ability of companies, even companies that are in bankruptcy or near bankruptcy, to be able to access capital markets and be able to borrow money at 3%, 4%, 5%. That's really what's going to keep a lot of large industrials going as we go forward here.
The other question we've received from the audience has to do with digital transformation. Does the pandemic... do you see the pandemic obstructing the progress of so many companies who are digitally transforming their operations, specifically in the area of finance?
Andrew, for us and from the other CFOs I've spoken to, they really have seized and are seizing this opportunity to actually accelerate their digital transformation. I think people are now, among my accountabilities, is executive oversight of our IT organization. And I will tell you that we are taking this opportunity to advance as quickly as we can along a number of venues in that space, because we really do view technology as being a key enabler for the success of our organization. Mm-hmm. And I think that other organizations will be looking at things, whether it's RPA, whether it's artificial intelligence driven thing, whether it's chatbots, not so much to, you know, displace workers, but to augment workers, to be able to leverage the workers that they do have to be even more successful. So I really do see the digital transformation efforts actually increasing these days and not decreasing. Because I think companies appreciate the fact that that is an area of investment that has an incredibly high return associated.
Hmm. Leonard, I can't thank you enough for sharing your thoughts with us. Thanks so much for being with us on CFO Studio Live. It sounds to me like the Nature Conservancy is certainly well led by your office as well as those of your colleagues. Sounds like you've got a great team, certainly putting in place controls and thoughtfulness that occurred before and throughout this pandemic. Certainly The Nature Conservancy is an organization that's sorely needed, not only here in the U.S., but around the world. You're doing wonderful work, and I wish you continued success and luck through, for yourself and your team and the organization as well.
Andrew, thanks very much for the kind words, and this is the best of success to you and your organization. Looking forward to working with you and others in this regard going forward.
Well, when we all come out of our caves, I'll look forward to breaking bread with you again in Washington. And I'd also like to extend that to our guests. I want to thank our guests for joining us today. This has been a great interview. I hope you'll all send your thanks to Leonard Williams at CFO of the Nature Conservancy. I'd like to remind our guests also that we have a number of exciting events coming up, which I mentioned at the introductory section of today's interview. Visit CFOstudio.com for a list of our events. They're changing daily, and we've got some pretty exciting folks coming up in future interviews. Leonard, thank you so much. To our guests and our friends, thank you very much for joining us. If you're commuting from the kitchen to the living room, be careful because there's some traffic at the table. Other than that, I hope that you all stay well, stay healthy. I hope that we get to see you again. And from me to you, God bless.
All right, take care, my friends.
Take care.